Is it my feelings, even my sexual feelings? Is that ultimately the very most authentic part of me? Or is it, for instance, my body? LGB is sort of predicated on a binary view of sex. A lot of lesbians are worried that it's going to erase it's going to erase their identity altogether. Born gay is pretty much that's pretty much been debunked outside of some political discourse, right? Activistic discourse. Rather than increasing the risk of suicide, it seemed to decrease in most cases. You don't need a ban. You can just go to your ethics board. The answer is not to ban this. The answer is to study
that's it right.
And help people. That would be the scientific approach to it rather than the political approach. So I think they're much more about intimidation, much more about intimidating therapists. And so no one's going to touch this. No one's going to touch the topic.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. Today's episode is one in a continuing series on counseling freedom for all, our series talking to statisticians, therapists, clinicians, and people who have journeyed away from an LGBT identity. My guest today is Dr. Christopher Rosik. He's a Phi Beta Kappa graduate from the University of Oregon, and he earned his doctorate in clinical psychology from the Fuller Graduate School of Psychology. He's currently a psychologist and the director of research at Link Care Center in Fresno, California. He's also a clinical faculty member at Fresno Pacific University. Dr. Rosik has professional interests that include the psychological care of missionaries and clergy, dissociative disorders, and homosexuality. He's published more than 50 articles in peer-reviewed journals on these and other topics, and he's made presentations across America and in Europe. Dr. Christopher Rosik, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Oh, happy to be here, Jennifer. Thank you.
Well, that's great. I became acquainted with you and your work through our mutual friend, Father Paul Sullins.
Sure.
And the two of you have been very involved in the worldwide debate over sexual orientation change therapy efforts. So tell us, Christopher, what is your role in that particular debate?
I am a clinician by trade, a psychologist, and I do see clients. But I also, this is kind of a weird thing for me. I balance things out by doing research. I like to do research. And so even though it's not a full-time gig, it is something I've enjoyed, and through my connections with the university, I'm able to, I think, do that. And in the last 10 years or so, focused a lot more on the whole issue of, sexual orientation change and, that area in particular. There's some other areas too in the arena of sexual orientation, but that's kind of been a real interest. So through that, and that's kind of been the way we got, Dr. Sullins and I got connected, really. And so we've, cooperated on a couple of different projects, and I'm not nearly as prolific as Dr. Sullins, but I've certainly appreciated the opportunity to work with him, and so iron sharpens iron, so to speak.
And how did you get interested in this particular topic? Is this something that you've seen a lot of clients about, and so you have some experience about it?
I'll give you my story, a real version.
Sure.
But this is actually goes back to the 90s. I work at a faith-based counseling center, and we have a program for missionaries and clergy. It's an intensive psychological pastoral care program. And even back in the 90s, I was noticing that although it's not the most common presenting concern, it wasn't unusual that clients would come, missionaries, pastors would come, and part of their concern was like same-sex attraction, for example. And they really wanted to try to do what they could to align their behavior and their attractions with their faith, the values of their traditional Christian faith. And back then in the 90s, we were still just even having debates about same-sex marriage. And I was listening to those kind of debates and how same-sex attraction was being equated with race, right? And so, and that was kind of the language that was being used. And I'm not a prophet, but I sensed even back then that equating would mean that in a lot of people's minds, you know, to try to explore the level of fluidity you might experience in same-sex attractions was being equated with like trying to change your race. And if that was the case, I could see coming that there were going to be attempts to, you know, ban it. That's crazy. You're trying to change your race, right? So knowing that this was probably coming, the environment wasn't going to get any better, I thought, you know, who's going to represent these people? Who's going to represent their values out there in the culture? Because these were, again, sincere Christian people wanting to have the freedom to choose to explore their sexuality. And if that gets taken away, I mean, who's going to help? Who's going to represent them? So that's kind of where my sense of call came into it. And the research came a little later, but I was doing some writing in that area before the research. But so in a sense, I'm trying to be a voice for those people that don't really have a voice in the arena of, you know, research.
It determines what you think is a worthwhile research question to ask in the first place.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. It's about, you know, you to really have an accurate scientific understanding of a topic, you need to have people coming from different perspectives, right? Because we all have blind spots. We're all human beings are subject to confirmation bias. And so the only way you really can protect a little bit, you know, against that is by having divergent perspectives. And so the field as a whole, as I'm sure you're aware, is what, you know, myself and others have described as it's a really ideological monoculture. It's an echo chamber.
Yes.
And when that happens, there's a real danger that, you know, there's an, you know, certain favored perspectives are going to not be subject to sufficient critical analysis. And therefore you're going to get, you know, incomplete understandings of the subject matter, you know,
That's right.
You know, changes in sexuality, for example.
But I think because of the monoculture is not just in your field, the monoculture is now everywhere pretty much.
Sure,
and
sure.
So the experience of some of these people is probably unfamiliar to the typical viewer here, you know, unless you've experienced it yourself. People may think, well, there's something wrong with it. If a person wants to change their sexual orientation, they must have some other problem, because really the right thing to do is to affirm your true self, your true identity. Trying to change somebody from left-handed to right-handed is not possible. So there's something wrong here. So I think it'd be helpful to people, you know, to just have a little insight into what people's lives are like, what their concerns might be.
Okay. Well, it's important from the start to remember that, you know, to use the language of sexual minorities, I know that's not everybody's favorite language, but I'll use it just to talk people who are non-heterosexual experience in their experience, that they're an incredibly diverse population, right? Mm-hmm. I think there's multiple pathways into same-sex attraction. And so for those seeking to, you know, modify those attractions or those behaviors, there's probably multiple pathways that they may need. And I think most change is what would be called naturalistic or spontaneous. It happens all around us. It's pretty ubiquitous for many sexual minorities. They experience change. I mean, that's pretty well established in the literature. What's more controversial is, can any change be facilitated or assisted by a therapist, right? And the narrative is, no, that can never happen. You know, it's kind of an interesting narrative. Mm-hmm. Yeah, spontaneous naturalistic change happens all over the place, but the one place it can't happen is in a therapist or in a therapist's office through the assistance of a therapist. It's an irony in my mind.
I agree with you. I totally agree with you. And we've been saying, based on looking at the papers that Father Sullins has showed me, not just his own, but, you know, the other things documenting what you just said, we're just saying, you know, people can change. It happens every day.
Right.
It literally happens every day, sometimes with therapy, sometimes without.
Their ability to have the freedom to explore this is being taken away. So like I said, there's many ways to into and out of, I think, same-sex attraction and identities. And the people that I have worked with, I have worked with some adolescents, you know, and in California, we have a ban about that. I don't promote change in that sense, but we talk about it. And frankly, most adolescents that come to me are, you know, they come from their parents bring them, right? And as I talk with them, I typically find that they're really not interested even in exploring that. And I have to honor that, right? So I work with the parents and I work with them to educate them and to help them, you know, stay in connection. I say, you got to love your child no matter what, stay in communication with them, navigate this. You never know how that child's views of things will evolve over time. That's different than with adults, you know, and with adults, you know, some, I would say some have experienced degrees of change. It's interesting. One of the things that there's some research about how relationship status and romantic feelings can be a naturalistic shift, can promote a naturalistic shift in sexual attractions for women. And I think for men too. I can just give you one example of a young, you know, it's happened a couple of times, young man who as a early teen was very, he said he had 90% heterosexual attractions, right? But as he got into pornography and explored the whole pornographic world, he found he responded to same-sex attraction. And so in responding to same-sex attraction, over a period of time, he found that, yeah, he was now 90% having same-sex attractions as opposed to heterosexual attractions. Wow. It was kind of a condition that seemed to go on. But what was interesting was that he would say, you know, when I feel comfortable with a woman, I find that those heterosexual attractions grow, right? So it was, there was kind of an aversion there and an uncomfortability. And as he, you know, as you work to feel more comfortable with a woman, he would report that the same sex attraction would diminish and his heterosexual attractions would increase. Now that was, you know, not everybody's experience is that way, but the fact that this does happen, you know, to me says we should not be something we're banning. This should be something we're studying more in detail so that we can help people understand what is likely, what kind of, you know, who's likely to respond and who's not, and what practices are likely to be helpful and for whom, and what practices are not going to be helpful and for whom. And we have some information on that, but there's a lot that we don't know, frankly.
Well, and you know, if somebody makes a sweeping statement, no one can be helped. All attempts are harmful. And this is the language that you're seeing, you know, coming at us from the advocates of the ban. That can be refuted by a single counterexample is enough to refute such a sweeping statement, right? And so in a way, they've painted themselves into a corner, but that's the nature of what we're dealing with.
Well, the way
with.
I view that is that, you know, a lot of these laws to ban therapies are, you know, they're sponsored by often LGBT legislators. And my hunch is, my sense is, it's, at least from here in California, these are people who perhaps have tried in some form or other for change. It didn't happen. It might have been very unsophisticated kind of attempts, but it didn't happen. And so now they're going to generalize their personal experience to everybody, right? Everybody. And that's very unfortunate. Because they don't talk to people like Dr. Sullins or myself. Typically, we have to go to them and talk sometimes if we get to.
And your clients, you know, and the clients and the people that you encounter and so on. So let's do now turn to your research, okay? Because I'd like to get out on the table for people. The papers of yours that I've looked at, including your response to the debate that Father Sullins is engaged you notice a couple of important flaws in the existing literature that is out there, you know, the people who are purporting to show that it never changes or it never helps or it sometimes hurts. What are some of the principal flaws that you found in that research, Christopher?
Yeah, and well, Dr. Sullins, he's done a really great service in basically taking this study that was done by some secular researchers, and it was a very good, at least in terms of methodology, in terms of being population-based. And the researchers concluded that, you know, that any exposure to China change efforts was increasing the odds of suicide and suicidal ideation and all that. Well, this was a, fortunately, this was a publicly available data set, and Dr. Sullivan took that and reanalyzed it, realized that there was a question there that could help discern what the pre-exposure level of distress was, which is the issue.
Right.
Right. And when he took that into account, which really is amazing that the authors didn't do that, when they took that into account, he found that almost the inverse was the case, that rather than increasing the risk of suicide, it seemed to decrease in most cases, or at least it was either decreasing or I think not related. So it really was a difference. And it suggested that, of course, that rather than the change effort leading to greater distress and suicidality, in fact, it was people that had greater distress and suicidality were coming for care, right? And so that they had a higher level before the exposure, so to speak. I'm using that in their language about exposure to change efforts. But anyway, and what I did from that was just look at all, since 2010, look at pretty much all the change research that had been coming out that was skeptical or critical, and kind of looking at their methodology and finding that there was not one single study that took into account the pre-exposure, pre-change effort exposure level of distress in their study. So it really means that that whole narrative is up in the air in my mind. Research is better, much better. And Sullivan's research would suggest that the narrative may even need to be inversed. So
if we could just state it simply for the benefit of people who haven't been immersed
let me give you a very simple way of putting it, okay?
And I've yes, please.
This is similar. If you were, imagine you were trying to understand the harms and benefits of marital therapy, and you decided you wanted to study marital therapy, former marital therapy clients, but you only studied those clients that were divorced post-marriage therapy. And you used that sample to determine how helpful or harmful marital therapy was. Does that make sense? You didn't study the people who actually benefited and are staying together. You only studied those who are divorced. So in a sense, you're studying the studies that are done are on clients, participants who are LGBT identified. And that's the second piece of this.
Yeah. So there's two points that are of importance. One is to hold constant for the pre-therapy level of distress. So if you thought, to use your analogies, is stick with the marriage counseling, if the people who are most in distress are the ones who choose to go to therapy in the first place, you can't blame the therapy if it turns out that therapy is correlated with eventual divorce. You can't blame the therapy because the people who are happily married never show up in the first place. But then the second point is, if the only people you include in your sample are people who are divorced, you're not going to see the people who benefited from it. And so the same thing that's happening with the LGBT clients, they're the ones who are most distressed. You and I suspect, and the other people, the opponents of therapy have not proven otherwise, we suspect that the people who are most distressed in the first place are the ones most likely to go to therapy. Mm-hmm. And then if you only look at the people who still identify as LGBT and you don't include in the sample people who left, who achieved enough change that they would no longer describe themselves in that way, it's like only looking at the divorced people,
right?
So are those the only flaws, or are those the two major flaws that you see in this body of research, Christopher?
The pre-level of distress is not accounted for in any of the research, and that it's the research participants are almost 85 to 100% in these studies LGBT identified. And so those who do not identify, who may have experienced have positive experiences, are excluded. It's also true that people, looking for change efforts are probably those whose attractions are least or less subject to change, because otherwise they wouldn't even come to therapy, right? They wouldn't even come to counseling. It would probably be some of that spontaneous kind of change. But there are other concerns. There's very little, I would say, not enough use of psychometrically established outcome measures, like, you know, scales of depression or scales of anxiety, whatever it might be.
Yes. But you've done a couple of papers yourself. Yeah. Okay, so one of the things you've done is you surveyed the literature, which is a big service right there in itself.
Right.
You've surveyed the existing literature. But then at the same time, you and a couple of co-authors have done another couple of papers where you had a sample that was not necessarily representative, but you were trying to take a look at a different subpopulation and see, well, are the results in any systematic way different? You had a paper in 2021 in the Journal of Psychology and Christianity. And what were your results in that particular paper?
I believe that was the paper looking at the people's, the participants' experiences of harm or benefit from certain goals of change. And
right,
I think
right.
What we found was that those who were, I don't have it in front of me, unfortunately, but those who were not LGBT identified tended to find some, you know, more often than not, some benefit in the goals of reducing same-sex attractions, reducing same-sex behaviors. I think the goal of eliminating attractions and behaviors tended to be more dicey. I think when we're talking about like categorical change from,
right.
from only having same-sex attractions to only having heterosexual attractions. And that's not the way it usually works for people. I know I've heard of cases, but mostly people change on a continuum of change, which even on a small change could be the difference between a marriage staying together or not. So it's not insignificant, right? A heterosexual marriage. So I do remember that the goal of like acceptance of your attractions was always very positive. And that probably meant different things for different groups, right? For the LGBT identified, acceptance probably meant, you know, embracing, acting upon. For, I think, the non-LGBT identified participants who were probably more traditionally religious, that meant acknowledging that I'm dealing with this, acknowledging that this is my experience, rather than trying to repress it, awareness of it, you know, and working with it in maybe different ways, rather not necessarily acting upon it.
You know, I think we should pause and talk about the issue of self-identification. Because you're alluding to it, and not maybe not everybody's familiar with what is there. That if a person is has a strong identification with their religious commitments, they may choose not to describe themselves as LGBT. They may choose to describe themselves in some other way. What would be some different ways that people would describe themselves if they didn't want to pin the gay label on themselves?
They might describe themselves as heterosexual, right? I mean, there's a large group of people who have mostly heterosexual attractions, but some same-sex attractions, but live kind of by and large kind of heterosexual lives. They also could just say, they say they're heterosexual with same-sex attractions, or they would say, I don't take any sexual identity label, right? So there may be any number of things like that, but what kind of unifies them is I do not identify as, you know, gay, lesbian, or bisexual.
And there's a whole movement that some people sometimes refer to as the gay Christian movement.
Right.
That movement is controversial precisely over the issue of whether this is an appropriate label or what does that label actually involve? Do you have any comment about that?
What we're talking about with these identities is, at some fundamental level, what does it mean to be an authentic human being, right?
Mm-hmm.
What is it? And is it my feelings, even my sexual feelings, is that ultimately the very most authentic part of me? Or is it, for instance, my body, right? And that gets into the natural law arguments, and you're familiar with those, I'm sure. But that, like, I think the traditional Christian would say, my body has some teleological significance for what God's intention is for sexuality, right? God created me this way, and my body in a certain way. And so when someone talks about being a gay Christian, there, to me, I get a little anxious about, well, how does that fit with a biblical anthropology, right? You're kind of identifying, you're saying this is a fundamental part of who I am. This is my identity. I'm identifying around this. I certainly can have same-sex attractions and be a Christian and be a marvelous Christian, a marvelous person. When we're talking identity, it is saying something more about my worldview, I think. This is an essential part of me, that I'm going to fundamentally prioritize as my identity. Right. And right. I think that's part of this divide between those who do not identify and those who do identify.
That's a point. We have several very good friends who are Christians, and one of whom actually wrote a book called Why I Don't Call Myself Gay, while acknowledging same-sex attraction and same-sex behaviors as part of his experience. You know, that's what I did, and that's how I behaved, and that's what I feel, but that's what I felt. But I do not call myself gay. And this is a guy who's resistant to the whole, you know, that whole language for the reasons that you gave, you know, that's not my fundamental identity. It's a fact about me, but it's not my identity.
Yeah, this comes even, it's come into even clearer focus with the, the momentum of the transgender movement, right? And what's the worldview behind that? I think it's just further out on that continuum.
Yes,
that who I am is essentially my experience. Who I am is my feelings.
That's right. That's right. And the body, the traditional Christian understanding that the person, what is man? There's an old catechism question. What is man? Man is a creature composed of body and soul, made in the image and likeness of God. You know, and so that's a body soul composite, not a radical dualism that allows you to redefine yourself separately from your body. You're not a mind driving around in a body like it's a car and that you can step out of and
right.
get a new one or something. Right.
So that's a fundamental distinction between a sort of a Judeo-Christian, I say, anthropology and a more secular view of that.
That's right. Yeah, I agree with that. And I think this little conversation is going to be helpful to a lot of our people who maybe aren't familiar with that whole discussion. So another paper that you and your co-authors worked on had to do with what kinds of things proved to be helpful to clients. Right. So you had a sample of people who identified themselves in various ways, and you had a whole list of things that might be helpful to them. And you just asked them, you know, was this helpful to you? Was that helpful to you in achieving your goals and so on? Can you walk us, or actively harmful, right? So can you walk us through that paper a little bit? Because that was really interesting methodology, a set of questions you thought of that I don't suppose other people thought of.
It's the only paper I'm aware of that really kind of had a higher resolution about this issue in terms of specific methods. Now, keep in mind that paper was not about therapy. Okay, these were self-initiated methods that people were basically using. These participants were using to deal with their sexual orientation distress. Okay, and we looked at a number of different methods that they used, and those methods. We were 33 of them, but they broke down into maybe seven or so different kind of factors. In other words, items that were related to one another in some way. And what we found was that, let's just take this distinction again between the LGBT identified and those who were not LGBT identified, that methods that were orientation neutral, in other words, things like learning to be more assertive, working through trauma, coming to accept the attraction non-judgmentally. Those kind of items were pretty universally beneficial, whether or not you identify, the participants identified as LGBT or not. But there were several items that had significant differences between the LGBT identified and non-identified, where the non-identified individuals found much more helpful. And these were items that tended to cluster around issues of wanting to affirm a religious identity, wanting to support that religious identity. And the other kind of factor had to do with restraining sexual desires, right? So these items might be things like focusing more on heterosexual attractions rather than same-sex attractions. Might be limiting the time I fantasize on things. Might be learning how others have dealt with their same-sex attractions. Might be prioritizing my religious identity. The bottom line was that these items were seen as generally more beneficial than harmful for those who were not LGB identified, but for those who were identified as LGB, these items, they rated them as more harmful than helpful. So again, this is when at the very least, it proves there's a great need for a lot more resolution on these items, on these issues, and certainly more resolution than the political climate wants to have happen, in my mind. We also looked at them from a theological standpoint, from a conservative theologically, participants who endorse that versus those who were more moderate or progressive theologically versus those who were sort of non-theological. And we saw a similar shift across that spectrum, whereas those same items that were helpful for the non-LGB identified were also rated as being more helpful and harmful that for the theologically conservative. But as you moved to the the less conservative theologically or the more secular, those items were seen as more harmful, right? And I should say too that there were some items that were seen as kind of universally harmful, and those tended to be ones that I think everybody should agree, things like shaming myself or aversive kinds of practices that some of those people don't do those anymore, but so there are some things that can be pretty harmful across the board. And I think even particularly Christian counselors and pastors should be aware of those things. And because, obviously the goal is we don't want to do any harm despite how we're portrayed.
And I noticed that in your conclusion to this paper, you actually say you'd suggest that clinicians across the board direct their clients or guide their clients away from punitive or aversive methods. For this reason, that they're pretty much universally harmful. And so did people report things like that people were doing punitive things, physically aversive therapies or things like that? Or was this imaginative that they were doing it to themselves, self-shaming or something like that?
I don't think there are many licensed therapists that would practice that, frankly, with anybody for that matter, not just sexual orientation.
Yeah, I don't think that's what I thought.
I think there might be, and again, I know a lot of like pastoral counselors, religious workers they do great work, but I think they're also less regulated. So there may be some outliers that, maybe don't have the sensitivity to this and certain ways of framing things that might be seen as, not pray harder. I know there's the pray away the gay kind of narrative, but I could see, some kind of self-shaming, encouragement to shame oneself or to, in some way or another, sort of beat oneself up emotionally or theologically because, hey, I have these attractions. And that kind of thing obviously would not be helpful at all.
Right. So, what I'd like to do now is kind of pause and take a break and go into a little bit different direction. Okay. People, you can join us over on our Locals channel if you want to hear the end of this interview, because now what we're going to do is I'd like to bring you into the conversation about the, you could call it the public policy aspect of this or the political aspects of this. I know you've been involved with some of the international organizations that are trying to take stand on this and have their views represented in the public debate. So let's pause. And we'll take that up in just a moment. All right, we're back with Christopher Rosik. And Christopher, if you could tell us, I'm aware of at least one organization, and I think you're involved in at least one, maybe they're different ones, but you're involved in the international conversation about bans on certain types of therapy and defining what kinds of therapy should be banned and what should be allowed and encouraged and so on and so forth. Tell us about the organizations that you're involved in and what they've been doing.
Yeah. Well, I am probably most identified with the Alliance for Therapeutic Choice and Scientific Integrity, which is a North American-based organization. So we do work in focus in North America, basically helping educate clinicians as well as the public and to some extent policymakers. The Alliance, we really didn't get into this as an organization to do political things. We're much more focused on how do you help people, and as clinicians, how do we, what kind of care is going to be most helpful for them in addressing their goals, especially if they're maybe change-oriented goals. But because of the way the culture's gone and the, these legislative bans and things, we've sort of been forced into the arena of having to address them, because obviously the clients we work with, their freedoms are being, threatened, and the freedom for therapists to provide care. The way I would put it is, yeah, the freedom of clients to choose their own goals and the freedom of therapists to provide assistance in those goals, right? And those goals should include, in our estimation, I think I can speak for us, they should include the ability to explore their potential for change, right? Without guarantees, of course.
You say you work in North America. Right. There are other groups around the world, and there are issues around the world. What are some of the countries that you think are the most troubling?
Canada is a pretty major offender, if you will, of rights in this area. It's very punitive laws right now. I know people working there against them, but they're very punitive, where just even making a referral, subjects the person to potential jail time. They're criminalized, really. In the States, wow. It's mostly about losing your license or some consumer fraud laws, which you might get sued. But in Canada, as I understand the law, really there's the threat of going to jail just for even making a referral to someone who does quote unquote conversion therapy, which again, no one really defines in any specific way in terms of what could I say that would get me in trouble. I would say there's Australia has some pretty draconian laws in at least some of their provinces now too. So yeah, Europe has some bans, but Europe is an interesting case in that they are, while they still toe the line, I think, on sexual orientation bans, they are really putting the brakes on the transgender
I've noticed that
issue. And so these big government reviews from places like Finland and Sweden and Norway and Denmark and France and the UK are all showing, hey, there's, especially for minors, there's just very poor, if any, evidence that these medical and other transitions are really providing any long-term benefit for these minors, but they're potentially causing great damage. So Europe is really putting the brakes on this, certainly the medicalization and medical transitions of minors, except for under very strict research protocol conditions, because that's a nod to the fact that this is very experimental. We are experimenting on this generation in that way. But in North America, for the most part, we're just going gangbusters ahead in spite of all this evidence and these systematic reviews from these European governments.
And here's something that really concerns me, because these European reviews are recommending watchful waiting and counseling for the child who's got gender dysphoria, rather than transing them or doing medical intervention. And yet I noticed the law in Australia that you were mentioning, in Victoria, I believe it is Victoria, Australia, they've got a law that prohibits counseling to change a person's sexual orientation or gender identity. Yeah, so the very kind of therapy that's being recommended, at least tacitly, by these European countries that are saying watchful waiting, counseling, that would be banned under the Australian law, if I'm reading it correctly. Am I reading that correctly? Is that right?
Yeah, you're right, Jennifer. In fact, it's not just Australia. I think the more recent laws in the States are including gender identity. It's a package deal now. So I know, and that's what's it's an amazing thing, that there just seems to be this incredible disconnect. So where's it going to go? That's what I'm interested in seeing. Where's it going to go? Will there be any kind of backtracking by like the APA and their full-throated support of this? Or will there be a point where, to save any kind of face and to feel credible to at least half the country at all, that they begin to sort of step back from this kind of full-on total affirmative care position? I don't know what's going to happen, but it's going to be really interesting to see maybe within the next 5 years or so, especially if this divide continues to happen. And then within American culture, there continues to be this sort of backlash and movement, I think, of the pendulum kind of back towards, maybe this isn't the greatest idea. Maybe there's something else going on
Right.
with our kids, right? They're not all just, coming out because they've had this for all their life. That this is this rapid onset gender dysphoria
That's
phenomenon,
right.
I think is unique and different. But anyway, what happens? It's going to be really interesting to see.
Well, and there are two questions that come to my mind. One of them is the whole idea of born this way. So part of the LGB narrative, or the LG narrative, I suppose, the lesbian and gay narrative, is that people are born that way, and therefore you can't change their sexual orientation. Now, to say that somebody is born trans is to affirm that they were born in the wrong body somehow. And that seems like a different scientific stretch, right? But I think that's the narrative that binds those two things together. The people who are saying we're going to ban therapy around sexual orientation change and gender identity change, I think that's what they think. Am I right about that?
Well, I know that's part of what's been, I mean, I've heard that for sure. I do think it may have even more to do with sort of if an enemy of yours, an enemy of mine who's an enemy of yours, you're a friend of mine, right? So those conservatives who want to uphold sort of traditional sexual moral standards, if you will, and want to say this is the moral exemplar of a society, of a flourishing society, the heterosexual sex between a man and a woman is the ideal in marriage, right? So I think looking at that conservative perspective and saying, yeah, they're an enemy of us, so they're also an enemy of the T, so we're together. So it's
Right.
kind of a partnership of utility in a way, and I'm not sure it's going to hold. We'll have to see,
Correct.
right?
Correct. Correct.
We'll have to
Because there
see.
are plenty of the L's are already busted out from the
Well,
alliance with the T's, that's for sure.
right. Well, the LGB is kind of, I think, is sort of predicated on a binary view of sex, to be honest. So it's interesting how that can, yeah, I think a lot of lesbians are worried that it's going to erase their identity altogether.
Well, and they're not wrong. I mean, from what I can tell, it's the lesbians and gays who see the body as somehow essential, who have at least some kind of essentialist view of the body, that it means something to be a woman, it means something to be a man. And in a way, to say I have a sexual orientation presupposes a stable bodily identity, right? If I'm only attracted to people of my same sex, well, that supposes that there is such thing as the same sex, right?
So, but to your question about stability, I mean, I think born gay is pretty much, that's pretty much been debunked outside of some political discourse, right? Activistic discourse. That isn't to say that it's easy, right? And that isn't to say it is different for different people. I think there's, a continuum here of people's experience. So again, that's why you do not promise change, because you don't know that person's experience, and we really don't know enough yet to be very predictive in that regard, based on background factors. How much change a person might experience. Probably, if they've experienced some fluidity in the past, there's more potential to experience that in the future. There's a lot of factors that go into it, and so again, that's why you have to take each person as an individual, their own
That's right.
experiences. And I don't determine, I always ask, well, how do you see your attractions and how do you understand them? I don't put my ideological or my view of causation onto the client. I want to hear what they think and work with that, right? And clients coming to me would say oftentimes, yeah, I think trauma may have played a role in this and I want to explore that. And so we work on the trauma. And a lot of times, like I say, when a lot of therapists don't really focus on same-sex attraction, they see change that can occur as a byproduct of working on other things like trauma, like assertiveness, like more comfort, less aversion in their relationships with women. We need to know more. There's always more to learn. But the fact that this kind of thing happens to me is enough to say, hey, the answer is not to ban this. The answer is to study and help people. That would be I think, the scientific approach to it rather than the political approach, the activist approach.
And let's pause for a moment on the trauma question, because one of the things that concerns me quite a lot about this whole area is that I believe it's true. I've seen studies that say it's true that many people who have a lesbian attraction or a gay attraction, that there's trauma in the background. Statistically speaking, they're more likely to have experienced some kind of trauma. And over here at the Ruth Institute, we're very concerned about childhood sexual abuse for a whole number of reasons, because we think it's part of the fallout of the sexual revolution. And we want to be sure we're not shaming victims and that there's justice and, you know, all those kinds of things that are, you know, it's an extremely complex problem. But it seems to me that if a person is troubled by their same-sex attraction and they want to talk about it, you could, or let's start the other way. You want to deal with the trauma. That trauma could lead them to say, gosh, maybe this is why maybe this had something to do with why my arousal is shaped the way it is today. Mm-hmm. And then if you as a therapist start wandering into that territory, now you're into dangerous territory legally. And that I can't imagine a scenario in which that's going to help anyone if that's really a part of that individual story. Can we really prejudge in advance of doing the therapy whether we want to shut off that whole line of conversation? That's what I and I'm not a therapist. I'm just speculating as a layperson in this area. What do you think about that, Christopher?
Yeah, I think, well, you're getting at something that I think these bans are about, right? I don't think so much that they think. That there's all these therapists out there who are doing this crazy stuff and hurting people tremendously. If that was the case, you know, there are already boards of psychology in each state that can really deal with this kind of thing, such as if someone was doing like torture therapy or something like that. Yeah, you don't need a ban. You can just go to your ethics board and they will suspend your license. So I really think that there's very few, only a few outliers maybe that could be called up on these laws. I think they're much more about intimidation, much more about intimidating therapists. And so no one's going to touch this. No one's going to touch the topic. Just therapists may be afraid to venture in because, you can have an ethics charge against you just for a person's perception, right? And it can take tens of thousands of dollars to defend yourself or just a false claim. So it can be very intimidating for therapists. So I think that's almost the bigger goal of these things is just we're going to intimidate therapists out of providing these kinds of assistance to clients, right? To help them with those kinds of goals that they don't like.
Now there's one other question that has come to my mind, and that is we're studying change allowing therapy or sexual orientation change efforts, conversion therapy, whatever you want to call it. We're studying that very intensely right now. Has anybody studied the impact of gay affirming therapy? Does gay affirming therapy make people feel better in the end? Does it help them manage their psychological distress and stuff like that?
First of all, I don't like the terms sexual orientation change efforts or conversion therapy. I do think they are, especially conversion therapy, it's really a term that has very little utility. It's kind of a political term that all the whores are poured into. And I think that's been, that term has been carpet bombed in the culture so that everybody thinks that's what happens when really it's,
right.
It's just ill-defined. There are a few studies that have purported to look at gay affirming therapy. And what I think the general results have been is that the therapy seemed to be helpful, but the gay affirming part really didn't add anything to it. Does that make sense?
I see.
So the, yes. the affirming part didn't really have, the active ingredient was not the gay affirming part, but the therapy part, like cognitive behavioral therapy or, you know, whatever the supportive kind of treatment was, some psychoeducation, that was really what led to the most benefit, not necessarily the gay affirmative part.
That's really interesting, but it just points to the fact that there are a lot of aspects of this thing that deserve to be studied, and that asking the right question is extremely important. And the politicization of the field is making it hard to even formulate the question, much less study it.
It's hard to study a thing that a therapeutic process that is under legal scrutiny and, you know, people wanting to ban it, right? Who's going to advance their career by that? That's part of the problem too, with the ideological monoculture. And, you know, if you are a researcher in this area, and I think there are researchers, but why would you jeopardize your career to research a topic like this and come up with some results and findings that may go against the grain of, you know, the current conventional wisdom? I mean, look what happened to Robert Spitzer, right? I mean, that's what people look at and say, man, I don't want that to happen to me. I don't want to lose my career, lose my peers, lose my research funding. So there's tremendous factors working against getting out a balanced understanding of this topic.
And I always like, whenever we have this conversation, I always like to say to any young people who are watching, you want to serve the body of Christ, but you don't think you're cut out to be a theologian or a pastor. Hey, dude, if you're a statistical guy, there's a place for you. You know, the body of Christ needs good statisticians and clinicians and, you know, all kinds of people with all kinds of gifts and talents. So I'd like to, we're coming to the close of our time. And so I'd like to give you the opportunity to just say a little bit about your organization, any organizations you're involved with, and how people can help or how people can be part of what you're doing. You already mentioned your alliance that you're part of. Who else should be joining the alliance, and how can other people help?
Yeah, that's great. We have places for anyone, really. That's part of how we've expanded over the last 10 years or so, to have places for anybody who's, certainly where our heart is with clinicians, and if you're a therapist or a pastoral counselor, we have an interest in, we put on some training for people on a monthly basis. I edit a journal that comes out every year that talks about these issues. People who just are supportive or want to get educated more about this issue. I would say too, as the editor of the journal, if a person has an interest, and it's a scholarly journal, but if, and the purpose of the journal is in part to provide an outlet for people whose work might not be, you know, well accepted, might be a little politically, quote unquote, politically incorrect in this area. And you can just go online and you could see what's already been, you know, we're on our 14th edition. So you can see previous articles to get an idea about that. But we'd love to have contributors. I'd love to have contributors who are interested in scholarly writing in this area.
And what's the name of that journal?
Oh, the Journal of Human Sexuality, right. There's a website for it as well. I think it's journalofhumansexuality.com. And it doesn't have to be research necessarily. We're open to other kinds of contributions. I appreciate the opportunity to talk about these things. I think there's such a hunger that people have, and especially in the Christian community, for information that's good information that matches their values and aspirations and things. And so the hard part is just getting the word out that we exist. You know, organizations like this exist, and your organization too, and are available for people. So thank you for that, for having me on. I appreciate it very much.
Well, I appreciate you very much too. Dr. Christopher Rosik, thank you so much for being my guest on today's episode of The Dr. J Show.
You're welcome. Thank you.